In the last two videos, we had a great reminder of what a system of equations is, and we started to work with row operations and matrices. Now we want to talk about row reduction and echelon forms, so I want to show you what some of those forms are. So there are two forms that you need to be familiar with. One is echelon form, the other is reduced row echelon form, which you'll often see as RREF, or sometimes you'll just see that as REF, which is reduced echelon form. If echelon form is kind of like the triangle form that we talked about in our last video, and I was talking about Gaussian and Gauss-Jordan elimination. In echelon form, all non-zero rows, and up to this point we haven't had any rows that were all zeros, but sometimes you do. So all non-zero rows are above all zero rows. Each leading entry of a row is in a column to the right of the leading entry of the row above it. And again, that's why it was triangle form, because as we were writing this, let's say I had, this would be a zero, all zero row, that would obviously be near the bottom or at the bottom. If you had more than one all zero row, they would all both be on the bottom or all. So, for instance, I could have something like 2, 7, 6, 3, 2, 0, because we talked about needing that 0, 1, 4, 9, 3, and then I might have even 3 zeros and a 7 and a 6. This would be an echelon form, and again, it looks kind of like triangle form that we talked about before. And again, all entries in a column below a leading entry are zero. So here I've got a leading entry of 2 and all zeros below it. Here I have a leading entry of 1 and all zeros below it. And here I have a leading entry of 7 and all zeros below it. And all of those rows, as we can see, cascade down to the right. That is called echelon form. If we want reduced row echelon form, then each leading entry in a non-zero row is a 1. And so in our last video, I kind of did that naturally as I turned them into 1s just because they were easier. And each leading 1 is the only non-zero entry. So essentially what we're saying is I've got a 1 here, and that's the only value on the coefficient side of the matrix. So obviously I can have something else on the right side, which is the solution. I might have a couple of zeros and then three, not three, it has to be a one. 1, 0, 4. And then remember, this would be illegal because they're not cascading down to the right. So I would have to have swapped those rows. I can have a one here, and then I still can have an all zero row. So that's an example of reduced row echelon form. It has all of the same things that echelon form has, but all leading entries are 1 and all non-ones are zeros. Pivots, what are they? What do we need them for? Well, a pivot you're going to hear quite often, and it's just terminology that tells us that we're looking at that leading coefficient in the row. So previously, when we talked about echelon form or reduced row echelon form, a pivot position corresponds to where the 1 would be in reduced row echelon form, or essentially, what's the leading value? So here, the leading coefficient is 1. And here, notice we've got zeros beforehand, so the leading coefficient is 2. Those are pivot positions in pink. The pivot column is just the column that contains the pivot position. And then a pivot is a non-zero number in the pivot position used to create zeros in your row operations. So, what we're going to do now is we're going to use these pivots and use essentially the same steps we were looking at in the last video, but we're going to solidify what those steps should be, which is of course the row reduction algorithm. So the algorithm essentially gives you steps to follow in order to find the solution in the easiest, fastest way possible. So the first thing you should do, of course, is to write it as a augmented matrix, which I didn't add that as a step because honestly, I shouldn't have to. So let's write that quickly. And my algorithm says begin at the leftmost non-zero column. So that's code for start right here. That's a pivot column. Select a non-zero entry as the pivot and interchange if necessary to move that entry into the pivot's position, which is row one. So we really want that first left-hand top row to be a pivot. And the only time that's not going to be a pivot is when there is no value in the first column, which really would never happen because if there wasn't a value in the first column, we just wouldn't have the first column. It would start at the second column. So I don't have to do step one because I already have a one exactly where I want the one. However, let's say this guy was my first row, then I would have to do a swap in order to get a one into that first position. Step two in our algorithm is to use row operations to create zeros in entries below the pivot. So here's my pivot. I want to now create zeros here and here. Now, as we can see, I'm pretty fortunate. I already have a zero in row three. To get a zero in row two, I would need to add negative two to positive two. So that's exactly what I'm going to do. I'm going to take negative two times row one, add it to row two, and that's going to be my new row two. Now, again, we're doing a lot of mental math here, but if you need to, you can feel free to go ahead and write the negative 2, 0, 6, negative 16 to help you in your calculations because I'm going to be adding that to row 2 for my new row 2. So row 1 is going to remain the same, and row 3 is going to remain the same, and row 2 is going to be 0, 2, 6 and 9, and then negative 16 and 7. So that is step two, is again to get zeros where we want them, and as we can see, we did get zeros where we wanted them. Row step three. Repeat this process for the remaining rows, ignoring rows you've already applied the algorithm to, and that means what the process was, get this to be a one and then get zeros below it. So that means my next step is to get that two to be a one. So let's do that. How am I going to make that a one? I'm going to take half of it. Half of row two will be my new row two, which means row one remains the same and row three remains the same. And row two is half. And again, decimals or fractions doesn't matter to me as long as the decimals are exact. And then how am I going to get a zero below it? I'm going to have to add them together. So I'm going to get a zero here next. And to do that, I'm going to take negative row two plus row three to be, oops. To be my new row three, which means row one remains the same, row three remains the same, and row two is going to, just kidding. Yikes. Row two remains the same. And then row three is negative row two plus row three. So negative zero plus zero, negative one plus one, that gives me the zero I wanted, negative 7.5 plus five, and negative negative 4.5, so positive 4.5 plus negative 2 is 2.5. Now what? Well, now I need to get a 1 again because I'm repeating the process over and over, and I'm going to keep doing that until I get all 1s, which I don't have yet. So how am I going to get all 1s? I'm going to take, and again, this is why it is better to write these as fractions. So that was negative 2.5, which is negative 5 halves. And this was positive 2.5, which is positive 5 halves. So how am I going to turn that into a 1? I'm going to multiply by negative 2 fifths, row 3, to be my new row 3. So row 1 remains the same. Row 2 remains the same. 15 halves and negative 9 halves. And then row 3 is essentially multiplying by the reciprocal, so the negative reciprocal, which gives me 1 here and negative 1 here. And again, we've repeated the process for everything. So we've talked before about how you can stop here. And if I stop here, that is going to give me a back substitution situation, but I want to have reduced row echelon form, so I want all of these guys to be zeros as well. So remember, reduced row echelon form has ones here and zeros everywhere else, or we could have an all zero row. Step 4 is essentially to ensure that each pivot is a 1. So the way that I just naturally do this is I always turn them into a 1. So I could have not used that as part of my process in steps 1 through 3. I could have just ensured that I have a value where in a pivot position and not necessarily that that value was 1. So I automatically just get that value to be 1. So I really don't have to do step 4 because I wrap step 4 into the first 3 steps. And for our final step, again, we already have 1s exactly where we want them here, and we have all of our zeros here. Our final step is to turn turn these values into zeros. So everything above the diagonal of 1s. So to do that, we're going to start working upwards and to the left, which means I'm starting with the rightmost pivot, which is the bottom 1, and I'm going to work upwards and then to the left. So I'm going to start here with 15 halves. How do I turn 15 halves into 0? I'd have to add negative 15 halves. So that's what I'm going to take times row 3 to get my new row 2. So I'm adding negative 15 halves times row 3 to be my new row 2, which means row 1 is the same. And row 3, we don't want to touch because we have it exactly where we want it. If I take negative 15 halves times 0 plus 0, and then, of course, 0 plus 1, negative 15 halves plus 15 halves gives me 0, which is, of course, the whole point. And then negative 15 halves times negative 1 is positive 15 halves, plus negative 9 halves gives me 6 halves, or 3. Now, from here, I would work upwards and to the left. And so, again, that means this guy now has to be a 0, and I don't have to worry about this one because he's already there. So my last step is to turn negative 3 into 0. How do I turn negative 3 into 0? I add positive 3, so I'm going to take 3 times row 3 plus row 1 to be my new row. Oops, where did B come from? I do not know. To be my new row 1, which means row 2 is perfect just as it is. We're not going to touch it. Row 3 is perfect just as it is. We're not going to touch it. Row 1 is 3 times row 3 plus row 1, which gives me 1 here, 0 here, 0 here, and then 3 times negative 1 is negative 3, plus 8 gives me 5. So that tells me that my solution, remember what this means, is I have 1x1 is equal to 5. This one tells me that 1x2 is equal to 3, and this one tells me that 1x3 is equal to negative 1. So my solution is 5 comma 3 comma negative 1. Now, in the last video, when we didn't go through the algorithm, but essentially we followed these steps, we never really checked our answer. But keep in mind, if you do solve a system, this should work in all of these equations. And notice that I've just rewritten them down here. So I should be able to replace x1 with 5 and x3 with negative 1, and that should equal 8. So 5, this is plus 3. Does 5 plus 3 equals 8? Yes, whoops. 8 equals 8, check, check. So it works for the first one. Does it work for the second one? That's telling me 2 times 5 plus 2 times 3 plus 9 times negative 1, does it equal 7? So that's 10 plus 6 plus negative 9. Does it equal 7? 10 plus 6 is 16. 16 plus negative 9 is 7. So I have 7 equals 7, and it works. And of course, then I would also check the last one, which says x2, which is 3 plus 5 times negative 1. Does it equal negative 2? 3 plus negative 5, does that equal negative 2? Negative 2 equals negative 2. And so again, I'm just that much more confident that my solution is correct.